Hello, hello, hello.
Hello.
Welcome to episode 97 of the T2s podcast. I am Nana.
And I'm Rose.
And together we are
T2s.
Guys, let me just apologize now because I am drowsy as hell. I took some pain meds for my period. Because I get really bad cramps. So I'm trying to get it together right now, basically. So bear with me in it. Bear with me.
Don't worry, guys. So how's your week been?
Do you know what? I feel like this week went so fast. Like, it's like I blinked and it was Friday, which, you know, yeah. I'm happy about because, you know, work is not always, I'm always looking forward to the weekend, isn't it, basically, for a break.
Yeah.
But it's been all right. I've been, now I know why I was so moody, like, last week.
Periods.
Yeah, because I was coming on and, you know, hormones and shit, you know. But yeah, how about you?
Yeah, my week was good. No, first week back from Jamaica. First full week back from Jamaica. It was all right. Like, I spent most of my week in bed, to be honest. I was tired, mentally tired, physically tired. I was just tired this week. So I spent most of my time in bed. And, but yeah, we did go out to Taylor's birthday. Taylor's birthday party. Shout out to Taylor.
25th birthday party.
Yeah, that was cute. And, yeah, now I'm here. Oh yeah, I did a little family trip. Twiggy's niece's birthday. So Ami went and all her friends and stuff like that. So that was nice. But yeah, the week's been a bit boring. Oh, we did the Google. We did a talk with Google at Google's workplace.
Yeah, that was pretty good. I really, really enjoyed that. Even though, like, obviously this week we have not been in the mood, but that was a highlight of the week, I would say.
Yeah, that was cool. Like, I think when we do these panel talks and stuff like that, it's always fun. It's always great getting the feedback as well. It's interesting to see what different workplaces do for inclusivity and to find out things about other people.
Yeah.
And even the process of working with these people to the outcome and whatever, at output, whatever happens, is all you can tell who cares and who doesn't.
Yeah, this, I would say that this experience was really, really positive. Like, even the questions that they asked were different to the questions that we usually get, because the questions are always about, like, like coming out, representation, but I feel like the host really mixed it up.
Yeah.
And gave us, I like, think the host, questions.
The host listens to the pod as well. So it's good. It's always nice when people actually know who you are and they know your work and they don't just assume things based on the articles that have all repeated each other anyway. So that was nice. That was cool. Also, when you do these panels, you meet other people. You meet other people that are doing stuff, whether it's queer people, straight people. You just meet other, and most of the time it's other black people.
Yes.
You know, we're always on panel with other black people because it's all the black departments that want us to come in.
Yes.
Yeah. And do you know what I liked about this one is they had a DJ.
Oh, that was cute. They had like an 80s DJ. So they played music for like about like the first 5 minutes.
Yeah. And he was even talking to the mic. He was like, he'll be knowing
it. Like, old school. Let's go.
Yeah.
Come on.
I love that. That was a highlight of the week. Yeah. That was cool. But so we're going to talk about our DMs. Yeah. Listen, guys, DMs. Yeah. We've been getting some weird DMs lately. So we're going to discuss it all. The last one I got, was actually, let me take it back, because the same person has DM'd both me and you.
Yeah.
And the first, when she DM'd me the first time, she DM'd me a dilemma about how she's a straight woman who's studying, and she studied, the woman that she's studying with, it didn't even make any sense what she said. She said the woman that she's studying with bought a strap, is what she said.
Bought a dildo out, yeah.
Yeah, bought a dildo out when they were studying
yeah.
and wants to have sex with her. And she's like, but I'm a straight woman. But this woman has been following me for years. Right. Like, as in before we had any platforms,
okay.
before anything. I feel like she's been following me, I want to say, for about 5 years.
Can I read out the DM?
Read out
the
DM.
I don't know if she copied and pasted the same one.
Yeah, because she DM'd both of us the same dilemma. Do you know what I mean? So we need to speak about this DM, yeah.
You definitely need to speak, because I've never ever responded to her.
I want to respond. Me doing Captain Save a whole year. I want to respond.
Okay,
I shouldn't have.
Some of the stuff that she says, like she writes, doesn't make sense. So I'm gonna try my best. But she said, so quick question, please. So I went to a friend's house to help her with her law assignment. So nothing major was going on, and I was doing the writing. So out of the blue, she gets her dildo out and also some lube, and just started to have a look at this and stood around looking at me. What's happening here, please?
The thing is, yeah. If somebody can't all of a sudden bring out a dildo and lube. That's not an all of a sudden. We know if you're bringing like sex toys, I'm not saying it's pre-planned, but you definitely see them rummaging somewhere or you see them moving towards the sex toy.
Yep.
And I just feel like it's just not something that just happens.
It's not.
Do you know what I mean? Like, there's a bit of a build up before that happens.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. So that was really weird. And I didn't, when did she even send this? Because I didn't respond. Me, I'm not responding. This
I
was,
responded.
This was in September.
Do you know I responded? I responded because she's been following me for years. Mm. And I just felt like, a part of me felt like, maybe do I know this person? I don't. I think they've just been following me for years.
Yeah.
But yeah. So she that's what she said. So further on, when me and her continue speaking, she then said that this person who's trying to move to her was they're related through marriage.
Okay.
And she said that person's married. Mm-hmm. She said that she's also married. Mm-hmm. And I was like, okay, do you want to take part?
Oh, she's married.
She's married. She's a married woman.
So why is she also in our?
She's married to a man. She's married to a man. So I was like, do you wanna take part in like the dildo and the noob? Like, is this what you wanna do? And she was like, yeah, I do. But I said, okay, maybe you should speak to your husband about it. And she said, her husband would never agree. Mm. And I said, would he not agree even if it's a woman? Because there's some people they don't, you know what I mean? They shouldn't, but they don't see it as serious, so they let them do their thing.
Yeah.
And she was like, no, he would never agree. Da, da, da. And then she started like kind of backpedaling and was kind of like, well, I'm not gay anyway, so like, why would I, kind of thing. And I was thinking, why did you DM me?
I think she's just an attention seeker.
Because she DM'd you, what else next?
Yeah, she DM'd me. So the other day, I must have, like, did a little story. I did a little story on my Instagram before we was going out, because we went out on Friday. And then she DM'd me, this stud has on mascara on, my man, Nana O, what's up? That's what's up. And
do you know what? I feel like you need to read a DM in an African accent. I'm getting African accent. Yeah, I don't know.
I think she's a freshie. I didn't know that.
She's like, a man or man. It's giving me man or man vibes.
On my man. But it doesn't make, look, read it. It doesn't make sense. Like, it does.
This stud has mascara on my man. I think my man. Nana O, that's what's up. But that's what it says, basically.
I was confused. I thought, what? Like, is she being like, what is she saying, that I can't wear mascara? That's what I thought she was saying.
Yeah, but I don't know. I think it's a compliment. I think what she's saying is that, Nana, that's what's up. Like, oh, yeah, you're a stud who's wearing mascara. That's listen, what's up. That's what I think she's saying.
The English wasn't English, in it. So I was a bit confused, yeah. And I came on a defensive tip, like, excuse me, people can do what they want, basically. Like, this person needs to mind their business. But also, I'm not a stud. This is what I need everyone to wrap their brains around. Like, I don't identify as a stud because I feel like studs really internalize that, you know, like toxic masculinity. And I don't do that. Like, I might be a nigga deep down inside, innit? I have nigga tendencies and I can admit that, but I'm not a stud. Like, I know I'm a woman. I'm not trying to be a man. Like, all that toxic masculinity bullshit, I'm not into. So, yeah, I just don't like to be labelled a stud.
Yeah, I don't like to be labelled a stud because, babes, you look and hear me, you can see my hands.
Right.
I mean, studs are meant to do that. Yeah. And if there's one stud, on TikTok who identifies as a stud, and loads of other studs and femmes are in their, they're this light skin stud with locks, and they're always like twerking and dancing. I enjoy their Snapchat. I think they're funny, you know what I mean? But there's bare people, you're not a real stud because you're dancing. This is what I don't like. Like, there's so much rules and restrictions to being a stud. Do you know what? Fair enough. If that's what being a stud is, fair enough. Yeah. That's not what I am.
That's not what I am.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah. If that's what the rules and regulations are, great. I don't identify with those. Yeah. So, like, me as well, like, nah, I don't
fit in the confinements of like that stud label. I never have. Like, and that's not something that I aspire to be. Like, I'm not aspiring to be some stud. Like, I am who I am. I don't like the labels because obviously there's restrictions. And like, yeah, I just don't fit into those confinements.
Yeah, it's mad. You know what's crazy is because I was out a couple of weeks ago and this girl came up to me and was like, you know, you have boobs. And I was so
excuse me.
I was bare confused. I was like, huh? And she was like, you know, you have boobs. And I said, I know. And I even touched her, like, yeah, I know. And then she was drunk in it. She knows who I am, but she was drunk. So it's funny to see like what her thought process was and to see like what she really thinks. And when she said that, I was like, yeah, I do have boobs and what are you saying, kind of thing. And she was just like, just don't forget you're still a woman.
Huh?
One thing about me is, this was when we went out to, you know, his birthday. It was about afterwards, And then she was like, oh, yeah, you're still a woman. The thing is, one thing about me, I will never forget that. Do you know what I mean? But having said that, though, I do think that sometimes me and you do this, when people are more on the more masculine presenting spectrum, that they're really masculine. Yeah. And everyone says things like, oh, they forget that they're women. But do you know what? They actually don't. That's just their expression.
Yeah.
They just explain. Yeah. I mean, it's just that we associate extreme masculinity with men. And sometimes I think that we forget that some women are just like that, but they're still women.
Really, gender and expression is really a spectrum. Like, and I don't think that you can like, I don't think you can box people in. Like, because I think even back, even like years ago, like when we first started coming up and stuff, yeah, I think we, because people were judging people in that way. Oh, if you're a stud, you have to be this way. You can't wear weave. You can't do this. You can't do that. And we were kind of like taking that on as well. Like,
yeah, we on I definitely think that we do internalize it a little
bit. Yeah, but now it's just like we can, we understand that people can do what they want. It's a spectrum, like, of like gender expression. You can do what you, everybody sits in different spaces and places of that spectrum, and they can do what they want. Like, even stud for studs. Like, that was a big issue where it's like, oh, if you're a stud, you can't date another stud. But if you're a femme, you can date another femme. That's okay. Like,
do you feel like you have a bit of misogyny there when it comes to stud for stud?
No, because I would date, like, I wouldn't date a stud because I just, that's not what I'm attracted to. But I would date someone who's masculine presenting.
Do you know what, I've had a few conversations with myself about this, and I do think that I have some internalized.
I think you do, there. Yeah.
I definitely think I do. I think that I have definitely, it's like, ew. In the front of my mind, I know there's nothing wrong with it. I know that it should be fine. Like, if you like women, then also you should, you know what I mean, you should be open to all types of women according to whatever your type is or your attraction is. But I feel like, I feel like if I do want to see two, you don't really see it in London anyway. I thought if I were to see two stars together, I think that my initial thought is raw. Like, oh. But then an afterthought is, oh, okay, this is nice, you know. I like that they're doing them. Do you know what I mean? I kind of fight between two different thoughts, but I know that one is toxic.
Yeah.
And I know that it's in some sort of internalized, automatic way of thinking that I need to reverse. And I think that even comes down, it comes down to internalized homophobia as well. It does. And, but yeah, definitely some conversation I've been having myself about that.
That's, you know, it's good that you've been having that conversation with yourself and you identify something, and even though it's negative, you're able to, do you know what I mean, like, be aware of it and say it out loud. So I watched Harlem. I know you watched the first episode. I've binged the whole season.
Oh, this whole thing out? I only watched two episodes.
Yeah, I watched it on Amazon Prime yesterday while I was in bed dying of period pains. And so I saw that first episode. Spoiler, if you haven't watched it, sorry.
If you watch it, you need to watch it because you've been, even lesbian gonna love that episode.
I think it was the first one,
when they had sex.
Yeah, when they had sex. And like, it was funny because, you know, the girl, one of the four main characters, they were like, I've never been with a stud before. Like, and do you know what it was? Yeah, I feel like that situation could have worked, but they're so alike. Did you see, like,
to me, I didn't think I was looking at two studs.
Then, but this is the thing, in terms of, like, the way, no, but I wouldn't even call them studs. I would call them masculine presenting.
I would say they're masculine presenting, yeah.
Yeah, because even, like, they do, like, I feel like the main character, she kind of switches up. So she wears makeup, but you wouldn't see her in a dress. Do you know what I mean? She wears, like, suits and stuff. So, yeah, she's not, I wouldn't consider her a stud. But, yeah, and they were very similar. And I think sometimes when you get too similar, two people that are too similar, it doesn't work. So I even heard some femmes say, oh, I can't date someone as feminine as me because, like, it's just too much. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's just too much of the same thing.
Do you know what's mad? These days, I'm shocked when femmes say they like masculine presenting. I feel like everyone, like, I feel like femmes are always like femmes these days. So when, like, shout out to Mojo from Peckham's Finest, yeah, obviously, she went on a date with our good sis Bianca on the show. If you haven't watched it, make sure you go and watch it, yeah. But even then, when she said that her type was masculine presenting, tall, she like, grr, that's what she said. And I was shocked. I'm not gonna lie, I was shocked. Like, I feel like these days, masculine presenting ain't the lick.
Especially if they're like bisexual femmes. I find that because they already date guys, they want to date something that's different to guys. Like, so they had a different, which is not like a masculine energy. So when they want to date something. So that was quite, I would say that was surprising to me as well.
I was surprised. I would say that.
I don't think we're the lick these days.
No, even a friend of a friend is also seeing, well, she saw a masculine presenting person and was like, yeah, like, she's not, but if initially she misgendered them and thought that they were a man, but it's actually a woman, and that they like them now. But even then, I was like, oh, because she said that she likes girls before. I knew that she liked girls before, but I just assumed that it was for these days. Whenever femmes say they like women, I just assume it's femmes. I just don't think it's masculine presenting.
And we're usually like, right.
I think a lot of people these days, even like one of our friends, normally likes femmes, and all of a sudden now she likes a masculine woman. Yeah. She's even like shocked herself. She's like, "Raw, like, I would have never said this is my type, but this is who she likes at the moment." And it's like, raw. I don't know. I'm even shocked these days. I almost feel like that dynamic is a bit dated, and it's where gender fluidity is a bit more, it's a bit more experienced, and it's a bit more, you know, people are experiencing it a bit more now and expressing themselves a bit more. I think it comes the same with relationship, the way relationships are. Mm-hmm. Back in the day, it would have been stud femme. That would have been, or mask femme, that's what, that would have been the standard. But now, and the way Gen Z is coming and crashing through and breaking down all the boundaries.
I love it.
Yeah, I love it. Like, even that, like, I think it's affecting what people like, and people are more open-minded, and I love that for our community. Mm-hmm. But I am a little bit older than the Gen Z, and I do think some of the way I think it's still a little bit dated sometimes.
Yeah,
but I'm also aware that it's that datingness is not correct.
It's, you know, true. I mean? Like, Gen Z are, most of them are pansexual, like most of them are like gender fluid, mm-hmm. and like express their gender in all types of way. One day it might be one way, one day in the next day it might be something else, and they're really just really mixing it up.
Yeah,
like it's so, it's like it's not binary at all, and I love that. I love the way that it's going. It's going in a more like fluid direction, and I like that, because me, as I said, like I would like, because I've done like the work of like, okay, because before I was like, okay, I wouldn't date a masculine person, mm-hmm. but why wouldn't I date a masculine person?
Yeah,
like,
that's what you need to figure out, is the why.
It's the why. Do you know what I mean? But there's actually nothing wrong with it. I remember seeing like two American girls. They were masculine prints, both masculine prints. There was a dark skinned one and a.
Oh, they used to go viral all the time back in the day.
And I watched their YouTube video one time, and it was a kissing one, and I got turned down. I was like,
they were going for it, boy. I remember that.
They were really going for it, and it was quite hot.
Yeah,
it was.
You know what's mad about that couple? Even watching them and do their thing, even then, I used to think, I always say, oh, that one's feminine. Even though it was two masculine presenting,
the lightest
it's almost
bunch.
Like I was still looking for which one is more feminine than the other one.
And there's going to be that, though, like, because as we say all the time, even you and me, we're not the same mask. Mm. Do you know what I mean? We don't identify the same. Mm. Do you know what I mean? Like, so there's always going to be somebody who's a little bit more mask or a little bit more feminine or whatever. And that's just how it's... That's how it is. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's how to cook a crumble chair. Mm-hmm. I had to cook a shrimp. I was about to say something.
There was another person who DM'd me last week that like annoyed me. I know she listens to the podcast.
Oops.
But it is what it is, isn't it? And I'm gonna say what I'm gonna say in it. So they messaged me.
Continue listening, though.
No. Continue. I appreciate you listening in it. Like, you know. But they messaged me and they were like, "Hello, Nana. Hope you're good. I see that you follow a certain guy, and he accused someone I know today of doing something, and it turned out to be wrong. He was called out for it, but he's going about the wrong way. It will hurt his brand. Can you talk to him? Can you talk to him to stay away from his phone? He's making it very worse. Thanks." And I was just like, "Wait, first of all, let me tell you something about me and Twitter. I go on Twitter and I tweet for myself. I might tweet, you know, a few things a day, but I don't really look at my timeline. So more time, I don't know what's going on that timeline. Do you know what I mean? I don't know what's going on that
timeline.
I'll
come to her and be like, "Oh, have you seen this?" And she'd be like, "No." And she's tweeting. I'm like, "Why has she not seen this?" Yeah, tweeting.
I'm not looking at my timeline, because like with my relationship with Twitter now is that, and I only have 3K followers, and that's not even a lot, compared to like the following that people or that other people have. But I feel like once you have a certain amount of followers, when you say something and somebody doesn't like it, people don't like it, there is like a witch hunt, and then other people jump on the bandwagon.
The more followers you have, the more witch hunt it's going to be for you, basically.
And people are really rude on there, and I cannot headbutt people through the internet. Can't do that. That's not an option. So that's why I tweet less. So I was just like to her, like, I follow the person, but I don't know him, and I don't know what's going on, as I'm not really on my timeline, and I've only probably interacted with them once, so it's not my place to say anything. And she was just like, "Oh, I assumed you were friends." But just because, like,
it's because you're someone who's a podcast, you're somewhat a public figure.
Oh, not
he's
a man.
Somewhat a public figure as well. I think they just assume they're all one. Click.
Yeah, I don't know. Babe. I don't know him.
We're not actually friends with other influencers like that, or other,
or even
figures.
people that we follow. Yeah, like it's Twitter, and Twitter is a social space, but it doesn't mean that's my friend. It doesn't mean that's my bedroom. It doesn't mean that I can go and say something to them, because that's not my place. But also in that, like, it's also about giving grace, isn't it? Because she was just trying to be helpful. Do you know what I mean? And she thought she could like help in this way. But yeah, it was just, to me, it was just like, it was just a bit weird. Like, I just don't know. I don't know.
I definitely think that people, when people have I think when people have bigger followers and stuff like that, they always expect
put responsibility
onto you, and there's a certain entitlement that people have of you as well. Like even so when we went to Jamaica on the way back, Twiggy's day two test, we didn't get a confirmation email from the provider because I put the wrong email address in. So I had to do a tweet, and then they DM'd me the confirmation. Someone DM'd me like 2 days ago and was like, oh, mind you, the person doesn't follow me or anything like that. He was like, oh, do you mind? I've got to say, I had the same issue that you had with this company, with my PCR test. Do you mind sending me yours so I can edit it? Because I need to get to work this morning.
I don't know you.
I didn't even respond. I was just, I looked at my phone and I fought myself between responding and not responding, and even screenshotting it and putting it on my timeline, be like, are people mad? And I thought, I was just thinking to myself, wait, hold on a second, I don't know you. You want me to send you a form with my personal details on there? It's even my personal, Twiggy's personal details on there, so you can edit it so you can go to work.
No,
babe, but if you live in this UK as well, you don't need that PCR.
Yeah,
if you go to work, then your workplace should be paying for your PCR. Workplaces that, when I did the Channel 4 unapologetic thing, they came to my house to do my PCR in my house. Do you know what I mean? Things like people have come to my house for professional reasons, bare time, to do the PCR, and Twiggy as well. So I was just like, I said, this guy's gone on holiday and he doesn't want to pay.
Yeah, that's what it is. He doesn't want to pay for it.
No, because the PCR test was for holiday. Mm. It wasn't for, like, it wasn't a domestic one.
You don't need it to go to work. So does he think you're stupid?
Don't work, use lateral flow. I didn't even bother responding. I was like, this guy thinks I'm stupid.
Yeah.
But like, that's what people do. When you have large followers, even like when I tweet about events, when I tweet about like just different stuff, I always get DMs, people that don't follow me asking me, oh, do you have a spare ticket for this? Oh my God.
Wow.
All sorts. Like, they just ask me all sorts of stupidness. The entitlement is crazy. And I know that they wouldn't message me this if I didn't have followers like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. They wouldn't message me. It's true. But yeah, that's what, like, that's the annoying part of being on social media, is that like people like put that responsibility on you to do certain things, or to like, I don't know, like service them in some sort of way. I don't know, like, or even respond. At the end of the day, yeah, like, we don't have to respond to people. We actually don't. Like, we choose who to respond to. And I mean, more time we get messages about, oh, like, oh, I love your podcast and thank you for like having this platform and stuff like that, which is great, and those are the ones that I respond to. But if it's anything else, like, oh, can you retweet my music, I'm not retweeting your music, I don't know, you don't,
oh,
you don't,
yeah,
follow
I get
me.
That as well, I get the music one. A lot of people, do you know what, this one's a bit sensitive, a lot of people also DM GoFundMe links, and a lot of times, yeah, I can't verify it. You don't follow me, I don't follow you, I can't verify if this is true. There's one person's page, I went on her page, and her page was literally just set up for this GoFundMe, and the cause of the GoFundMe changed. When I say I went through her timeline from the beginning to when she starts submitting that speech, I saw that at first it didn't make sense. So she's been pregnant for about 2 years, first of all.
I'm done.
Yeah. I was just like, what? And then everything, and then you know when people reply, you have to hide the replies. She kept hiding the replies. People kept saying this is fake.
Right.
And then just kept DMing me to, can I retweet, can I donate, can I whatever, and then I just blocked her, and then she DM'd me from another page.
I'm
like, you
done.
Blocked me. And you know, and it's mad, and even I get some GoFundMe pages from like people abroad, and they send me like really gruesome pictures, and it's because I have the therapy fund, that's why they DM me. And it's quite it's disturbing. Do you know what I mean? It's disturbing. When it comes to crowdfunding, you don't know. It's up to people if they wanna help you. Do you know what I mean? At the end of the day, I think that I donate to bare GoFundMe pages. I donate to people that they don't know what my actual name is. So like, there's people that they do follow me. I follow them back. These Gen Z, queer people. When you guys say, oh, I can't pay my bills this week, a lot of them, when they post their PayPal link, I always send like a £10 all the time. But none of them have ever, I see them out, one or two was at your party, but they never thank me because they don't know what my real name is. Do you know what I mean? So which is absolutely fine.
Yeah.
But that's how you should do it. It should be like that. If somebody wants to donate, then they will.
Yeah, then they will. And it's absolutely up to them if they want to.
Entitlement is too much. For me, I think that one of my pet peeves is that kind of DM. And it's because I've got the funds. That's why people DM. Because it wasn't happening before the funds.
Because that happened to me.
Listen, there's that one. There's when some people, there is one person as well, actually. She always DMs me quite, she always DMs me stuff about my experiences. So last time she DMed me, and I'm pretty sure she listens to the podcast as well. You podcast listeners, you can't be entitled, babes. So you just I beg, don't be entitled. But even this one, she DMed me about my art experiences as an LGBT couple in Jamaica. Mm-hmm. You respond and she doesn't say anything back. And I looked at my, I was like, hold on a second. So I went back to the other DMs. She's DMed me something before. I forgot what it was, but she DMed me something else before. And before that, and both times, she hasn't, after I've explained what everybody says, she hasn't said, oh, thank you. Oh, okay, cool. That, there's just no, it's just the next question. Like, and there's even another guy I went to college with, and he always DM me things about the LGBT community, but it was never to that far an understanding point of view. It was always from a debate point of view. And the last time he tried it, I was like, shut up. This is me. You always DM me. If you, and you think you're someone who, we used to be friends. We used to go to church together every Sunday, yeah? And I used to drop you, you and your family are home every day. After, I used to drive past my house to drop you home and then drive back home. And I was like, bro, like, every single time we speak, it's because you're messaging me to debate about LGBT people's existence. I was like, stop messaging me. This means, in fact, I'm going to block you after I say what I need to say. Like, you have not out of all the years we've known each other, you've seen me accomplish so much
from and you never say
having a child
that.
To this point, to me having this platform. You've seen me, you've seen my journey, and you haven't commented on one part of my journey ever. You, on the other hand, I've seen you have losses. I've seen, even when I've had, when I lost my brother, you didn't tell us, you didn't say nothing to me.
But
I've
if you want to debate about LGBT,
this is what I'm saying. I've seen you lose a parent in this time. I've seen you get married in this time. I've seen you do all this stuff, and every single time I always reach out to you. So I was like, bro, don't ever message me again. He's like, oh, I see why, I see why you would think that, but there's no but. It just is what it is. And that's why you couldn't argue with me.
It's so annoying when they say I see how you could see. No, it is what it is. Like, that's mad. Like, that's actually madness. Like, there's some people I have time for, but there's some people I just don't have time for. I remember one girl, she DM'd me on Twitter about, like, she was going through it with her girl, and like her parents are so homophobic and stuff. And I was like, you know what? Here's my number, call me. And I spoke to the girl for like 20 minutes on the phone. I don't remember her name. I don't even remember the girl's name. I just remember that she was young, she was Ugandan, and she was really nice. And I spoke to her, and I was just like advising her, because she was going through it with like her parents and her girlfriend at the time, who was scared to be with her because obviously of the homophobia from family and stuff like that. But yeah, that's like, I have time for certain people, but certain people I don't have time for. And you can always tell when people are not genuine, because they want to come and do debate and questioning people's existence, all that bullshit. I mean, you can tell.
Yeah.
And it's boring.
Mm-hmm. Like, you can give them this number. I've given my number to like three. Yeah, I've given my number to three people. And one of them, I think she was somewhere. And I was like, how are your friends with this small babe? It's like, no, I mean, she's like, give her my number from the DM, innit? And then she even sent me a calendar invite today. She's going to listen to this. Shout out to you that we should meet up here. And then there's another one as well. She listens to the podcast too. She sent me a really long DM, and I was like, do you know what? It's just better if I speak to this girl on the phone.
Do you know
what I mean? So I just gave her my number, and she hit me up, and we spoke, innit? And I have these genuine people who are younger, black, queer people who genuinely just wants an older queer sibling to speak to. I've got time for. Even people who are our age, and they go through some of the similar things, I've got time for them too.
Same.
I can't have time for everybody. I'm just put that out there. I don't have time for everyone. But if I've got the capacity, then I'm gonna be there for you. Do you know what I mean? But these people that have the entitlement, the people that who want to debate, oh please, I don't have time for that one.
Yeah, no, I hear it.
And we don't have time for all of it. Like, wow, it's crazy. Do you know what? Yeah. Do you know what we were talking about? My ex influencer, babe. We don't even talk about her this podcast. We don't. But I'm gonna talk about it today. We don't even talk about my ex influencer, babe, on this podcast, because she gonna cry. But so not after we said that she posts videos.
I heard from her. Like, I ain't seen nothing. I haven't in time.
Well, we both blocked each other for years now, so I don't know. I mean, so anyway, when you asked me that question, if she's still about yet, I thought, let me go and look. When I went home, I went to look. The seconds. Most searched thing, her name was her name and girlfriend. I was like, I was like, wow. And to me, I thought about the entitlement that people have. I know that, like, even on gossip sites,
our names are on gossip sites.
2020, so we stopped dating in 2018, but from 2020 to early 2021, my name and her name together are still on gossip sites. And I know it's because everybody wants to know what happened. And the entitled, why are people so invested
in
titles?
So invested in people's lives. It's so mad. Like, but I get it, because there's also people on YouTube that I love to watch and stuff, but I'm also not entitled. Like, it's just, it's a, like a positive thing. Oh, like, I enjoy these people, they're entertaining. But it's also like, I think with other people, it's just they want gossip. Do you know what I mean? They want gossip. They want to be in the know. They want to know what's going on in the ins and outs and stuff like that. Listen, do you know
someone
what I mean?
Said, I know from a reliable source, this is what she done to Ro. And I was like,
how do you know? Like, yeah, what is this? Who is this reliable source? Do you know what I mean?
Like, he is a reliable source.
Even please. My name is on that gossip site. Like, me and Martha's name is on that gossip site. And it's like, yeah, that's Rosie's friend's nana, and they're dating this person.
It's funny how this one had lesbian, now she's a lesbian.
Like, it's actually, it's madness. It's absolute madness. And I see, like, that people, obviously because we're friends, like, they put us in the same box. So there was even a time where an email was sent to someone about us being fuckboys.
Oh, and it's the influencer babe.
Yeah. And certain things like that. It's just like, you can't really judge a book by its cover. Like,
the person
who's
in the email knows us. Whoever the person was is somebody that knows us. To this day, we're never going to know who it is, yeah. But whoever it was, they definitely, they know us. Do you know what I mean? The things that they said in the email, they just know us. Do you know what I mean? And it's just, it's mad. It's crazy. It's crazy.
Don't be entitled, guys. It's really cringy, because also like a kind of obsession as well, and it's not healthy. Like, it's really, really weird.
Yeah,
like, it's weird.
It's really weird.
Yeah, I don't like that. I don't like that. And I know. Do you know what it is as well? Like, I was talking to my friend the other day, and she was just like, "It's because people think that they feel like they know you." We sit on this podcast and we talk the things. We talk about our lives, and you know, we're really open. We're really, really open people. We're not afraid to say certain things. Like, and that's why, like, when people listen to the podcast, it's like they're listening. They're like having a conversation with their friends, or they're listening to a conversation. Like, and we're very relatable. So people really do feel like they know us. But honey, you because at the end of the day, we do share a lot, but we also keep some stuff. Yeah. Like, we don't share everything, so you don't really know us. But you know,
yeah. And obviously people only share what they're comfortable sharing.
Yeah,
people only share things that what I feel is not going to be a negative impact on our reputation. Do you know what I mean? And that's, I guess that's just human nature. Yeah, like, you don't post things online. Like, for example, one of my friends was like, was asking me how me and Twiggy were. Me and Twiggy had an argument, and I was like, me and Twiggy had this argument, whatever. And then she was just like, you would never know. This is what her response was, yeah. A friend, by the way, she's like, you just never know what people are going through. You can't believe social media.
You can't.
And I was just like, you can't. But babes, you know mine and Twiggy's relationship. How dare you? How dare you say that? Yeah. But it's true. Me and Twiggy are not going to post our arguments online. Do you know what I mean? Like, and but at the same time, if we're going through some really turbulent times, we're not going to post each other at the same time.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
But yeah, but you just don't know what people are going through. Like, and that's what I hate about social media. Like, I have really a love and hate relationship with social media, because people do post the best. And that's what you're going to do. You're going to post the best version of yourself. You're going to post the best version of your relationship, etc. But it's not all, you know, it's not all fairy tales. Do you know what I mean? Like, like, life isn't black and white. Life is difficult at times. Life is challenging at times. Like, and that's the realness of it. That's the real. That is the real. So for you to see a picture or pictures of a relationship and think, oh, couple goals, I want this.
Everyone, please stop calling me to give pop couple goals. Please stop doing it. Please stop doing
it. Like, there's no such thing. There's no such thing. Like, you know, we all, you know, want things that we touch to be successful and stuff like that. That's the aim, but it's always not straightforward. It never is. Do you know what I mean?
This year, what's the biggest lesson you've learned about relationships or about yourself through your relationship? Both questions.
About myself, I think that I'm not. But I think these are things I think that I can be quite selfish.
Okay,
and I think that I can be quite impatient as well. And these are negative things, innit? Like, but I'm not scared to say, oh, like, I'm not perfect. And these are the things that I've realized. And I've realized that relationships are hard and they take consistent work. Like, every day, basically, relationships are a choice. Every day you wake up and you choose whether you want to be in that relationship or not. And, you know, the work that you do, like, obviously determines, like, which way that goes. Like, you have to choose to love someone every day. Like, you choose, I wake up today and I choose this person. I choose to be with this person, you know?
Yeah.
How about you?
I think what I've learned about relationships is that they are hard, but a lot of what makes relationships hard is what we go through as individuals.
Yep.
And I think that when we go through things, as individuals, it's going to affect the relationship. And I just only realised that, I would say, at the latter part of this year,
mm-hmm.
because there's been personal things that have, like, I've lost my brother, I've been mm-hmm. grieving for a whole year, mm-hmm. Twiggy got her ADHD diagnosis, good things have happened for us too, like, you know, things have been popping off for the podcast, mm-hmm. things have been popping off for Twiggy's career, like, these are all personal things, but they affect our relationship, and also Twiggy moved out, and I think that was a personal decision, but it still affected our relationship, mm-hmm. and, yeah, so I guess, like, but when things affect your relationship, I think how to handle it is something that I didn't know. And I just didn't even acknowledge that when you go through personal things, it affects the dynamic mm. of a relationship. And I think that when you're going through something, your partner kind of has to have a little bit more patience and grace
mm-hmm.
and not censor themselves around your pain or mm-hmm. around your experiences that you're going through, because it is about them ultimately. And that's definitely something that I didn't, like, for example, Twiggy moving out, it means that our communication, we're speaking all day, every day, mm, do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Now it got to a point, Twiggy, before we weren't used to making time for each other because we were always together. And I guess when you're not used to doing something, you kind of forget that you have to do it.
Mm.
So even though me and Twiggy still see each other all the time, yeah, it became like, who's making effort? It becomes like, who's making effort? Who's calling who more? Mm. Who's setting updates more? Stuff like that. And even me saying that, it's not even a huge issue because me and Twiggy see each other all the time. Mm. She's in my house right now. Like, we still see each other all the time.
Yeah.
But it was something we had to get used to.
Mm-hmm.
And she moved out because she needed her own space, like, figuring out her ADHD and stuff like that. And I was seen as, oh, she's not calling me when she gets up, but this is not actually, she needed her space. So mm-hmm. I need to remember that. Do you know what I mean? And if I was grieving and then Twiggy, I wasn't in the mood and I wasn't explaining why I wasn't in the mood, Twiggy would feel like I'm upset because of her.
Mm.
And then she has to just realize, oh no, my baby's actually grieving, you know. Mm. Like, it's hard because I've been continuing with the podcast and continuing everything normally. It's hard, do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So I think these have been the biggest lessons. When you, I think when there's two things that really affect people's lives, when you lose someone and when someone is born, those are the two biggest life
changing
things, and it changes you as a person forever.
Yep.
And your relationship just doesn't know how to, just might not be ready for that. And it's both things, I mean. So I think, yeah, that for me, that's something I've definitely learned this year. I'm happy that we've come out on the other side of it. Mm-hmm. I'm happy that we both know that, and we know we're now figuring out ways how to how to manage
mm-hmm.
changes. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So I'm glad that we're good there. But and about myself, what I've learned about myself through the relationship, I think I've learned about myself through the relationship that I don't always communicate how I'm feeling.
Mm.
Yeah, I don't always communicate my feelings because I put Twiggy's feelings first
mm-hmm.
and her needs first. So, but when you do that, it builds resentment because you feel like, oh, like, I need this. And she, you know what I mean? But I need, she's not Mystic Meg.
Mm.
I gotta say.
She can't read her mind.
Yeah, but she can't read her mind, innit? So, like, Twiggy does everything that she knows that she needs to do.
Mm-hmm.
But the things that in my mind, she can't read that, I need to tell her.
Yeah.
So that's definitely something that I've learned about myself too. Yeah.
I do feel like communication is, like, the foundation of, like, relationship. Like, as you said, like, we're not, like, people are not mind readers, not going to know what's going on in your head. You need to talk about it. And I'm quite a confrontational person where, like, if I don't like something or you've made me feel a certain way, I'm going to say it. I might not be the best at articulating myself, because also me, like, I do realize that I can go from 0 to 100 real quick. Like, I'm impatient.
Mm.
I have, like, my patience is very short, and that's something that I've identified and something that I really, really do need to work on. It's just, like, having patience and, like, having grace for people.
Mm.
Because I don't always do that. Like, I rush to start shouting, like, Janet.
Janet is Nana's mum.
You know, I've grown up in an environment where, you know, it's just shouting. There's no levels to it, basically. Like, it's just, like, the first thing to do is, it's just to start shouting. And, I don't want to be like that. I don't want to do that.
Mm.
Yeah, do you know what I mean? So something definitely that I'm, like, looking into for myself. Yeah, but, like, me turning 30, like, in the last, I would say, 3 months, has been a madness. Has been chaos. Like, internal chaos. Like, this is not even things that outwardly, I've got a good job. Like, do you know what I mean? Like, I'm all right. I have a roof under my head. Like, I'm good. Mm. But internally, like, the revelations that I've been having.
That's return, boy.
That sat return knocks me down. And I would, like, because your sat return starts happening like from 27. This is
yeah,
what I
around
heard,
27,
right?
28, yeah.
Around 27, 28. Why did it come in the last few months?
No, I think, you've been going through it, but I feel like
I haven't noticed
it gets more intense before, because for me, it got more intense before I turned 30
as well. Right, right, right.
So I think, because think about it, we started the podcast like when you was like 28.
Yeah.
And yeah, like this is not something you would have done before that.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
so I think that, yeah, you were going through it.
Things have been happening, yeah, but they definitely got intense like in the last few months.
Mm.
And yeah, it's just been a fucking internal whirlwind. That's what it's been.
You know, I do think that through your Saturn returns, I've seen that you're a lot more expressive about your emotions now. I think that you're a lot more, even expressive with words, but I think you're also more expressive even with looking at your face. Mm. Before some, you know, no,
really?
Before that, that's whoa. But now, I do definitely think that you are just, we've come a little bit more soft now.
I think so.
And I think I do think you also give a bit more grace. Even you not being patient as well. I do think that because you know that you try. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I think you do try now. Mm-hmm. She's still not the best patient, but you try.
I'll be trying.
Yeah, and I just think that you are definitely just looking at yourself internally a bit more than you used to. Not everything is so black and white now. No. And I think it's a journey, isn't it? And you're getting there.
It is. But I'm glad, because I think even with our relationship, even though we've been friends for 6 years, we haven't always been that expressive.
Like, we're not expressive people. We're just not because
the thing is, we've grown up in households where people didn't talk to each other about their emotions and stuff.
Yeah.
We're not used to it. Do you know what I mean? Like, we come on this podcast and we talk about issues and stuff like that. But when it comes to talking to about our feelings and our emotions, like, it definitely been lacking.
Mm.
Definitely been lacking. Like, and I think it's because we are not used to being vulnerable.
Yeah.
Like, honestly, being vulnerable makes me feel sick. It absolutely makes me feel like I could throw up. Do you know what I mean? Like, it makes me feel sick. But it's just, you have to go through the uncomfortable to be comfortable. Like, and that's something that I've also realized. Like, you have to be uncomfortable to be comfortable. And it's a journey. I'm not there yet. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not comfortable yet, but I will be.
I think that when you're pushed to be uncomfortable to be comfortable, and there's something that clicks inside, it's not even that deep. It's not that bad. So I think it's actually okay.
Yeah.
As long as you're in a space that's safe,
mm-hmm.
it's okay.
That's one thing as well, like, that has been very present, like, in the last few months, is like safety. Do I feel safe? Are people creating a safe space for me to be vulnerable? And yeah, like, it's and I feel like when you don't feel like it's safe, you have to ask for it to be safe. Do you know what I mean? You have to ask the people around you to create a safe space. If you don't feel safe, you have to ask. And if that person can't provide a safe space for you, then maybe that person shouldn't really be in your life.
When you say that, I remember a couple of weeks ago I said to you, I was talking about like our different friendship dynamics. I was like, I don't know. I'm not sure. Do you know what I mean? I started to doubt a lot of the friendship dynamics, and because of this safe space and like how we're able to express ourselves in those spaces. And then I spoke to Natalie, shout out to Natalie, and Natalie was kind of like, you just need to know that some friends are for certain things.
Yes, true.
And others are for other things. So you have your friends where you express yourself emotionally and that's your safe space, and you have your friends that you go out with.
Mm.
And she's like, sometimes both of them are not the same thing.
Yeah, no, it's true. And 100%, I understand that. And I think, you don't try and get that from certain people. Like, you shouldn't you shouldn't expect that from certain people, because that's not what you're gonna get. But yeah, shout out to Natalie, because even like Natalie, I feel like I can chat to Natalie, and feels like she can chat to me.
Yeah, 100%. That's why we go to Natalie's house, we don't leave. We're just when we go to Natalie's house, we do not leave. We're just always like, last time we went to Natalie's house, what was it, last week?
Yeah,
after your birthday. Yeah. After Nana's birthday. Why were we all still sleeping on Natalie's beds?
It's also like 11 a.m.
Yeah, and the thing is, she always lets us do this. Like, Freya wants to fall asleep on her bed, and she has to go sleep somewhere else in the house. So shout out to Natalie. She didn't know Natalie done this to the podcast, but whatever.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's someone, that's definitely a friend who creates a safe space, non-judgmental, like, express yourself. She's gonna be real with that advice. That's what it is. You know
that's
what I mean?
The thing as well. Like, I feel like when it comes to me, I am a bit harsh. But and also I'm learning how to be like less harsh. So my approach has definitely changed when it comes to like people and their issues. And I do feel like I'm a bit of a Captain Save-A-Hole. And that comes from like my relationship with my sister and just wanting to protect her, even though I'm the younger sister,
yeah,
wanting to protect her, you know. And I feel like I see that in my relationships with some friends as well, where I just want to save them, I want to protect them and stuff like that. But my approach before with my sister was very like harsh and tough love, and I've began to see that that's not the way to go. It's not a good approach, and so I've dialed it back a bit.
It's not for everyone.
It's not.
It's, you can't have a one size fits all for when it comes to stuff like emotions, because emotions are so varied, they're so personal, they're so unique, and
everyone's different.
Yeah, everyone is different. You have to, and some people you can't shop for.
Some people you just can't shop. Yeah.
But guess what? Someone else is gonna shop for them. At least you tried and you love them and stuff like that. That's what it is.
Yeah.
But we also want to talk about coming out, like outing people.
Yeah.
We're gonna talk about outing people, yeah. Because I feel like, I think obviously we all know you're not supposed to out people.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? We know that's like a rule, like it's dangerous and stuff like that. But I do think a lot of people do it.
Mm-hmm.
I think a lot of times it's innocent.
Mm-hmm.
I think a lot of the time it's because, for example, like if someone is obviously gay, and it's like, okay, the person's obviously gay then. Do you know what I mean? Or you're just talking because the person's obviously gay, you're talking about them like they're a gay person.
Yeah.
That sometimes, but it still might be uncomfortable for that person.
Yeah.
I remember like we stopped being friends with somebody. And she went and told someone that we were all friends with. There was a girl that we were all friends. No, I won't say we were friends with her. It was a girl that we used to see when we used to go out. And she was out here on the scene. Like she's in all the gay pictures online. Like she's just out here at every single event. But her family didn't know that she was a lesbian or whatever. And one of our friends, when she stopped being friends with us, she went to the girl and told her that I outed her to somebody. Mm-hmm. Now, I never outed her to somebody. So I think one of her friends that also was hanging out with us. Remember, it's a carnival with her, all this stuff here. She was hanging out with a bunch of gays as well. She was a straight woman, but she hung out with all of us gays.
Yeah, I remember.
But she was close friends to this other girl that we always see in the club.
Mm-hmm.
And we were all out together one day, and the straight woman said to me, "Oh, how do you know so-and-so?" Mm-hmm. And I said, "Oh, from the gay raves." I just thought, absent-mindedly, because that's how I know her, isn't it? I sat from the gay raves. And then when this other girl stopped being friends with us, she went and told the girl we always see out that I outed her. And I said, she went and told so-and-so that you're gay. I just said that's another girl. But the thing is, to me, it was very innocent because I know her from the gay. You, the girl that even asked me, she comes to gay rave with us too. That's a straight woman.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? A lot of straight people come, women especially, come to gay raves. So I absent-mindedly said it. I didn't think it was, I was out in
but
her.
But you didn't say she
like
was gay. It was just like, I saw her.
I didn't say that she was gay. I just said, I know from the gay raves. And then when I saw, the next time I saw this girl out, she's like, "You outed me. I saw your friend. This is what she told me." And I just felt like the girl definitely said it maliciously because we're not friends anymore. She's definitely a loser for doing that. But at the same time, if there was no malicious intent, I don't have an issue with you. Like, why would I go out my way to out you kind of thing? And I just feel like that happens. But I think that happens a lot. I think people are innocently outed. And I think it's even for me to acknowledge, you know what? It was uncomfortable for her. Mm. So maybe that was for her, that was outing her. Do you know what I mean? It's uncomfortable for her.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
I mean, obviously I was outed, didn't it? My sister outed me. And for a long time, she didn't understand, like, what she did. Mm-hmm. She didn't understand that it could have potentially been, like, dangerous for me. Like, you just don't know how people are going to react to you being a queer person. You just don't know. Like, you just don't know. Like, so it can be dangerous. My sister didn't understand for a long time. I had to keep explaining it. Like, you know, it just wasn't your place to do it. Like, it was for me to do it. Like, when I felt comfortable. Because when you realize that you're, you know, queer or whatever, it's like a really uncomfortable journey. Like, it really is. And it's a long one as well. Like, I would say from maybe 14 till about 25, I felt very, even maybe after that, I felt very, very uncomfortable with who I was as a person, as a queer person. I didn't fully accept myself until maybe a few years ago, maybe 2-3 years ago. Do you know what I mean? So like, it's very, very uncomfortable. And I feel like people just don't understand, like you just wanting to know, or it's not about you basically. Do you know what I mean? It's not about you. It's about me and my journey and my truth and how I feel about it, you know, because you're not living my life, you're not having my experiences. But I don't think people quite understand that, you know. So people will want to be in the know, or they want to gossip, or they really want, but it's not your business.
Even though I know that some people, they do want to gossip, and it's like they actually don't care at the same time.
They don't care.
I understand, but it's still someone's personal journey, and it's just about their comfortability, and it's just about stuff like that. Even now, recently, I know that this girl thinks I outed her, and I didn't. Yeah. Do you know that one? But I am the queer person in that situation, so I'm gonna take responsibility for it because I just know better. Do you know what I mean? I am the queer person in that situation.
Yeah.
Even though the other people came to me like on a, oh, I already knew kind of tip. Yeah. Even then I should have just said to them, oh, I don't talk about it. Do you know what I mean? I don't talk about it. And even though they came on, oh, everybody already knows, whatever, I still could have, I am the queer person in that situation. So I could have taken that opportunity and educated them about that. I did say to them, you know, people's journey. And it's a bit, you know, this is really difficult for them to navigate, blah, blah, blah. And they were like, oh, do you know what? That's true. Yeah. I hear that. But still, I still think that I could have just shut down the conversation because I am the queer person in that. So yeah. Definitely.
No, it's a hard thing. Like, it is a hard thing. I just don't think that people that are not, like, people who aren't queer just don't really understand.
Yeah.
Because they don't have to go through it. So they
don't understand. If you are the queer person in that situation, I just think that you have to, even if there's someone you know you're not necessarily friends with, you kind of have to take control of the situation and just shut it down. Do you know what I mean? Because I guess it's our responsibility within that. But yeah, but I do see some queer people can't wait especially if it's someone, especially with men, if the man is being homophobic online, but everyone knows that they're undercover gay, the gays can't wait.
They cannot wait. Like, this guy, they'll be doing like, I know about this guy.
If you go, there's always some sort of little subliminals that's like trying to out them and stuff.
Yeah.
Even stuff like that, No one should be out on somebody, but I get why they do that.
And also, a lot of the time, when guys are being homophobic, then other like queer guys would be like, "Oh, they're DL, they're gay, or they're just trying to hide it with being homophobic." That's not always the case. Some people are just homophobic. That's not the case.
Some people are just homophobic. Yeah. Like, oh, if you want to have sex with me, you should have just said, like, Boosie. Like, a lot of people think that Boosie is some undercover gay.
No.
Do you know what? Yeah, apparently he's. Well, actually, I don't know.
I'm done.
I don't know if it's true, Sha. But like, yeah, people say that.
Nah, I don't think.
That's why he's giving too much energy to it. But we don't know.
We don't know. Yeah, I can't say it's not true, but yeah, we definitely don't know.
That's all we know. He's homophobic. True. We just say he's a homophobic man. That's it.
He's homophobic. That's all I get. But it's true. Mad. I mean, just don't, like, if you're a straight person listening to this, or even a queer person listening to this, like, when it comes to people, it should be up to them to come out when they're comfortable. And we've also spoken about, like, for me, like, I'm just like, I'm not coming out anymore. I don't even feel like people, if they don't feel like coming out, they just shouldn't have to come out. Like, I think, was it this year, Queen Latifah finally, like, came out.
What, alluded to the fact that she has a
woman? Well, she said, because she won a BET award or something. Yeah, a Lifetime award, I think it was. And at the end of the award, she was just like, she loves, you know, the wife and the baby. And she said their names.
Oh, they have a baby.
They have a son.
Oh, that's cute.
Yeah, he must be about one now, I don't know. And that's the first time she's like publicly acknowledged, you know, her family, her queer family.
Yeah.
And it wasn't even made into a big deal. You didn't even hear about it.
Everyone knows.
Yeah, like
even me saying everyone knows, okay, that's a bit bad man to say that too. But
yeah.
We've seen pictures, you know what I mean?
Pictures and stuff. Do you know what I mean? And I thought, oh, that's nice. And I like the fact that people didn't make a huge deal about it, you know. That was also nice. And it's just like, you know, I don't feel like it's people's responsibility to come out for other people necessarily. I mean, it's nice. Do you know what I mean? Because obviously when we was growing up, we didn't really see queer people of colour, like they were masculine presenting as well. It's nice, but it's also up to you. It's your choice. Like, there's nobody, and nobody should take that choice away from you, you know? But yeah. Wrapped. Spotify Wrapped. Quickly.
Spotify
Wrapped is a lie, because Drake was number one on my Spotify list, and I don't really listen to Drake that much. So what's going on?
Who's my number one?
What is going on?
Wizkid. Wizkid was one. Okay, Wizkid was probably
that makes sense. That's I even listen to Wizkid more than I listen to Drake.
Drake, do you know, Drake was on a lot of people's, but he wasn't on mine. But I don't really listen to rap music, so he wasn't going to be there. I had Blast on mine. So everyone will keep saying,
isn't there like one song that Blast has?
No, he's got a whole EP.
Oh, damn.
What do you mean? He's had a whole show. How are you going to have a show for one song?
That's true, you know. That's actually true.
Blast on my Summer Walker's on mine every year.
Oh, is it?
I love me some Summer Walker.
Really? I didn't like any of them.
not a big fan of the new album.
It's not like it's, it was not touching.
It wasn't really giving what it's supposed to get.
I don't know what it's called.
We spoke about this on the Off the Cuff podcast. Yeah. So listen to our episode of Off the Cuff because we spoke about Nails.
Nails, yeah, that was.
I mean, I'm thinking about Nails.
Oh yeah, Nails.
In my mind, Nails normally on my Spotify rap, but she wasn't this year.
Oh, it's because you didn't listen to that new album.
I don't want her to know this.
We love you.
She's still my favorite though.
We should be able to say what we don't like and what we like.
Yeah, I'm gonna give it another chance though because I feel like I can grow to like it.
I don't know about that. I like probably like two songs on that album. I think it was called Amazing Grace and Wait. Yeah, there's only two songs that I really enjoyed on that album, and yeah, but I've been listening to a lot of Adele. Album. Okay. Some people don't like Adele's album because it's slow. It's like,
I haven't listened to it, you know.
It's not like Adele's always been that artist that doesn't have these like, she has fast songs, but
rolling in the deep
is
the fastest he gets.
There's other songs, but like, it's Adele, innit? Like, she's not gonna make,
that's not her style.
Yeah, she's not gonna make R&B tunes or like City Girls tunes. Like, yeah, that's not her style. So there was a lot of people that were saying that her album's boring. But nah, I really love the album, innit? Like, and I just love Adele. That's my babes. Shout out to Adele, man. Yeah.
It's been cool. But even the podcast, Spotify rap that we get as podcast creators as well, was quite interesting. So we'd like, our followers went up by 159%. It was good figures. Do you know what I mean? It was good figures. But you know what I'm thinking about podcasting, yeah? You don't know what good figures are. Like, you actually don't
what
know.
What do you have to compare it to?
What's a good
like,
figure?
We don't know what to, like, we don't have anything to compare it to. So what is the good figure?
Yeah, like with YouTube, you can see, all right, this person has a million views.
Yeah.
This person has 100 views. Mm-hmm. Like, so you can kind of weigh up. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You can see what you could potentially get. Mm. With podcasting, you just don't know. And I feel like this year, I was trying to pre other people's Spotify raps to see what everyone, other people's day is saying.
Yeah.
I guess to compare.
Yeah.
Like, just to be honest, I guess to compare.
So you know.
And nobody was posting this. Like, Burly. People were posting Burly.
Last year, people were posting.
But this year, people are Burly posting.
There was also a post last year that said, they made, in a certain genre or category, they were like either number one, number two. That one didn't come out.
Yeah. When they said, last year we were 50th society and culture.
Yeah, society and culture.
That's what I wanted to know. Yeah. They never put that out this year. So I don't know. A lot of people weren't really forthcoming with their Spotify podcasting information.
It's been a difficult year.
You know, we've been nominated for quite one or two awards.
And even when it comes to the award, I'm not, because we don't do this for awards, so and I remember like getting excited about one of the awards. I think it was last year, earlier this year. And then when we didn't win, I was just like, do you know what? The award thing, I can't focus on that.
After that one, we said, do you know what? The last one, I'm gonna just put it out there. The last one we were nominated for, I said, you know what? That's for us. We've got that one.
And there was people that were like, we thought you were gonna win that.
Yeah, this is not.
But
even
I didn't
to
get
be,
my hopes up.
Listen, this is not even not, to be big headed.
I didn't even get my hopes up.
But we have done the shit this year. I'm so sauce. I'm so sorry. But the podcast has, and the thing is, the category that the other podcasts, they've been doing, what, some one or two of them don't even exist anymore, but they were still nominated. but whatever, their podcast is still online, innit, to listen to. So cool. But I just feel like we've been really consistent. I just feel like from what was in the category, I just feel like we had a strong chance of winning. Even if I was someone that was sitting outside of, I would have picked you too.
Yeah, but that's what someone said to me like earlier this week. They were like, I really thought your podcast was going to win. I was like,
And you know, I think it's good to have these conversations because I feel like people don't want to humble you all the time. But no. I think people should know what their worth is.
Yeah.
I think people should not be realistic about what they can and can't achieve. Mm. And I feel like that's definitely something that we could have gotten. I feel like we couldn't attend this. I feel like we didn't win because we couldn't attend the ceremony, to be honest.
No, it was a busy week.
We couldn't be there. It was a busy week.
It was my birthday.
We just couldn't go. And this is not to take away from the winner. I think the winners, I checked out the winner's podcast and the podcast is actually really, really good. Mm. So like, big ups to them. You know what I mean? Congrats to them. But that's just how I feel about that. And when it comes to award ceremonies, but even before when we got nominated, I said we're not going to win. Remember, I said we're not going to win.
Yeah.
And I think when it comes to award ceremonies, nominate us, do what you want, go for it. But it's not going to determine our worth.
Do you know what I mean?
It's not going to determine our worth. We're still going to do us. And that's that, really. But in regards to the Spotify Wrapped, I just want to see everyone. I was being nosy, innit?
Yeah, no, because last year was really good. Like, it was really good to see, like, you know, people get, like, listed and where they were at and stuff like that.
You just want to know what's achievable.
Yeah, you want to know. Yeah.
When I saw the receipts one, yeah, I was thinking, I remember looking at it thinking, rah.
Yeah.
This is mad. Like, this is levels, you know what I mean? And I guess that's why you want to know. That's why you want to see. Like, you just want to see what is really achievable and what you can really do with podcasting. But nobody wants to share the data this year, so.
Fine.
So it's all right. You still do you regardless. You just create your content for the reason why you're creating it in the first place anyway. And I guess you just keep it pushing.
Yeah.
But what podcast would you recommend for us and our listeners to also?
The Echo Chamber.
Yeah, I would say the Echo Chamber was the number one listened on my Spotify.
Oh, I didn't even check mine, but it probably was because that's the only podcast I listen to.
Mine was Echo Chamber. My second one was Take Time with Twiggy, so check out Twiggy's podcast.
Yep.
And my third one was Tutu's. And that was it.
And then obviously Dapples. Listen, if you're into sports.
If you're into football.
Yeah.
Yeah. Dapples in the room right now. Dapples also on Sky Sports News, guys. Yes. He was doing that. It was actually really good. Yeah, did you watch it?
I don't like sports.
Yeah, but you can watch Dapple though, talking about sports. I didn't know what he was talking about, but I still watched it. Yeah. But it was really good. And
but yeah, if you love sports, and I know a lot of people love sports because every day I come like timelines, football is on, and I'm like, football again. Mm-hmm. So yeah, listen to Dapples podcast, Time to Attack podcast.
I was gonna say, and not everybody knows who Dapples, you have to say the name of the podcast. Counter Attack podcast. Yeah, and I think that's all really. I mean, we have to listen to Classic Manny's podcast as well.
Yep.
Black Girls Living.
Shout out to Black Girls Living.
Manny and Black Girls, and especially Vic. Manny and Vic, yeah. Oh my God. I can't even express how grateful I am for their support all the time. Yeah. Like, they're amazing.
Yeah.
Love them too. And their podcasts are genuinely good. Mm. Like they are my commute to work podcasts. Mm-hmm. That's what I listen to when I'm on the way to work. And yeah, I think that's the podcast for me. Shout out to all the other Black podcasts out there doing their thing.
Yeah, off the cuff too.
Off the cuff. Shout out to Off the Cuff podcast. Mm-hmm. It's actually been a difficult year from studios opening, reopening, for them being closed at the top of the year.
Yep.
To figuring out content. Also, shout out to what's Kaz's podcast called again? Kaz and Cole.
Oh, I just had it. Tea time.
Let me check it out. Tea Time Podcast UK. Yeah. So shout out to Tea Time Podcast. It's about the Black trans experience. That's presented by Kaz and Cole, our two favourite trans men. They're actually my two favourite trans men.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
They're actually my two favourites. Yeah, but shout out to them. They've got so much going on with IG Lives. And they even do the IG Lives, people like B Hawks, who lives in America. Mm. And like lots of non-binary and lots of trans awareness, which is really cool.
Yeah,
and I've actually learned quite a bit from them. They're like watching back their lives. Mm-hmm. I didn't even know there was a Trans Remembrance Day, and they were speaking about that, which was really cool.
Yeah, I enjoyed their podcast as well.
Yeah, their podcast is actually really cute. Mm-hmm. We need to get them on here so we can collab.
Yep.
Or we need to go on theirs.
Yep.
But yeah, like that's other Black queer people that you can support. Do you know what I mean? Even watching Peckham's Finest, there's bare Black queer people on that show.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, we also talk about Black queer representation. We have it on ITV, on Peckham's Finest. Mm-hmm. So there's a gay man in there. There's a bisexual woman. There's a non-binary. I think there's a trans person too. But there's definitely a non-binary person on there. And yeah, check it out. That's a lot of Black queer representation on the mainstream TV.
We'd love to see it.
Dark skin as well. Mm. Dark skin representation that we always speak about, and hopefully we can get them on this podcast so we can speak about what they've been up to on the show and just talk about that representation and thank them for it as well. But yeah, man. Guys, thank you for listening. I sound really bunged up, so I hope you can hear me properly this week and understood my words. But Nana's gonna go home and sleep now. She had drowsy. Remember I said that she's her emotions. I can see the emotion now. It's drowsy.
Yeah.
She had to go to sleep.
I'm tired. I really tried, isn't
it? She tried. Yeah. But yeah, thanks for listening, guys. Make sure you use the hashtag Tutu's Podcast in Conversation on Twitter. Mm-hmm. Make sure you thumbs up, subscribe, comment down below, share. Until next week. Make sure you rate and view us on Apple Podcasts and follow us on Spotify. Follow us on Spotify so our next year Spotify Wrapped is even doing more numbers. Until next week, peace.